Welcome to the highlights for Directory Opus 10.05. To show you this first thing, I'm going to first create a raw archive using Opus, and then I'm going to open that archive using 7-zip. After I've opened it in 7-zip, I'll try and delete it, and that will fail because 7-zip has the file open, which is fine. But this is what I wanted to show you. So Opus will now tell you which programs you need to close in order to complete that deletion. Unfortunately, this only works with a straight delete and not when you're using the recycle bin, and it also won't work with Windows XP, but hopefully you'll still find it useful. Opus now supports the portable app system when exporting to a USB device, and the main benefit of this is that it will tie into the portable apps launcher, as you can see here. When you do your USB export, Opus should automatically detect portable apps and will show you a red icon for the drive. The rest should be taken care of for you. We also now support Explorer replacement mode when running from USB, and the update checker will no longer prompt you to install updates when running on a portable install. When the update checker detects a new version, it will now put an icon into the status bar to tell you. We now have an option so that the update checker itself is never displayed automatically, and you'll only see the icon. You can then click on the icon whenever you're ready to process the new update. After you have downloaded an update via the update checker, you're now given the option to save the installer, should you wish to keep it for another time or another computer. If you do choose to save it, you can still run the update from within the update checker. We've added a new background colour option, which is used when the quick filter is active. To demonstrate this, I use quite a bright colour, so it's easy to see. When I start filtering, the window's background colour will change immediately, and this now makes it really clear when a window has a filter applied. Another thing we've added is, in the drop-down, there are counts of each file type, so you can tell how many files match those filters. Now, to talk about a different kind of filtering, I'm going to apply some different ratings to my files, and I'm going to do this using some buttons that you can find on our forum. Now I can demonstrate that the Find panel can look for files based on their ratings. So you go to the Advanced tab, add a new Ratings clause, and in this case I want to search for the files that have a rating that is greater than or equal to 4. And this should find those last two JPEGs and none of the others. And there you go, it does what you'd expect. Grouping is made easier in the new version, as there's a group option when you right-click column headers. If you don't see this option, you may need to reset your Lister column header context menu. As you can see, it's very quick now to group by different things. It's now also possible to group by columns which aren't displayed in the window. Within the Folder Options dialog, there's a new grouping setting, and it's called Keep Folders at the Top when Grouped. As you can guess, this will keep the folders group at the top of the window, even if it isn't naturally sorted there by the grouping and sorting order. You can now also group by columns from shell extensions, such as this one that shows source control status. Tiles mode is now on par with Thumbnails mode, with support added for jumbo icons, CD cases on music folders, and for labels which can change icon colours on files and folders. We've also improved the display of overlays, such as these shortcut arrows. Thumbnails mode has new functionality which you may find useful if you often work with several copies of the same image in different sizes. To demonstrate this, I'll quickly make thumbnails out of these first two JPEGs. As you can see, the thumbnails in each pair look identical, and the only way you could tell which is which is by looking at the small dimension numbers beneath, and that's not very good to tell at a glance. So in this case, the image on the left is much bigger than the one on the right, but the thumbnails look the same. To help you deal with this, we've added a new option called Relative Dimension Bars. If you turn this option on, we'll overlay some bars at the bottom left of each thumbnail, which show you their height and width relative to the other files in the same folder. Now it's easy to tell which is the small file and which is the large one, as well as compare the various files with each other. Archive formats for comic books can now be turned on and off individually via preferences. In addition, we now display special thumbnails with the cover of comic books, so that should look much nicer than before. These are treated like any other archive, so you can double-click them and use the image viewer to page through the files within. We've made some improvements to do with archive formats with file extensions that have multiple parts. So if you rename a tar.bz2 file, for example, only the main filename part is selected and not the .tar extension as well. Similarly, if you duplicate a file like this, we'll add the word copy before the tar extension and not after it, keeping the full extension intact. In the viewer pane, you can now zoom in and out by holding Ctrl and using the mouse wheel, the same as you could already do in the standalone viewer. You may find this a bit easier than using the buttons in the border or the optional toolbar. Another improvement to the viewer pane is that when you open and close it, we now ensure that the selected file remains visible instead of potentially being scrolled out of view as it could in the past. This change also applies to the metadata panel. The viewer's movie plugin has been improved so that when you click on the track bar, it will jump directly to the place you clicked instead of jumping towards where you clicked. The same change has also been applied to the thumbnail size slider and one or two other places as well. If you often have lots of folder tabs open, then you're probably already familiar with this overflow menu. In the new version, we've added another way to deal with this, which is a menu listing all of your open tabs. So to show you this, I'm going to edit my toolbar by going into Customize mode. First, I'm going to insert a menu where the list of tabs will appear. I'll give it a nice icon, which is a tab-related one. And a name, obviously. And also make it show the label on the right. So that's just created an empty menu, and now within that I'll add a button. And this button just acts as a placeholder which will turn into the list. So you make it run the go tab list command, and I'll add on the icons argument and make it show images just to make it a bit more pretty. And now if I exit customize mode and open up the menu I just made, you can see the list of all the tabs with icons as well. And you can now change tabs using that menu. Another thing that we've added helps when dealing with groups of files where the base names are the same and all the extensions are different, such as a movie and a subtitle, or a multi-part archive. So I'm going to edit my toolbar again to show you this. And I'll just insert a button this time, set the label on the right again, and give it a name. I haven't chosen a very good name here, but it doesn't matter. The command you want to run is select similar base. Now, when I exit customize mode and try this out, you'll see that it selects the other files within each group. So there it selects the subtitle file, and that also works if you do things the opposite way around, of course. If I select anything from the archives group, it'll select all the others. And this also works with multiple groups at once. If you're already familiar with creating Opus buttons, then you may already have come across the dialog password code, but just in case you haven't, this allows you to put a code into a command, and it will display a prompt when the command is run, asking you for a password, and it will insert whatever you type into the password box into the command. So nothing new there so far. What we've added is the ability to show a dual password field, where you have to type the password twice for confirmation. The new dual field is obviously good for when you're encrypting things, and you want to make sure you didn't have a typo, because the password you type will be used regardless. The old field, on the other hand, is good for when you're decrypting things, because if you put a typo into that, then obviously the operation will fail and you know you did something wrong anyway. Some toolbar buttons are only enabled when files or folders are selected. And that makes sense most of the time, but it also caused a problem when dragging files from outside the window over the toolbar, which you may not know you can do, but you can. We've fixed this problem now, so that whenever you drag something over the toolbar, all the buttons become enabled, even if nothing is selected in the main window. Like the old menus on the back, forward and up buttons on the toolbar, we've added similar menus when you right-click the small buttons in the file display border. That should be fairly self-explanatory. Updating existing layouts has been made a bit easier in a way that I'll demonstrate. So I'll just open up a layout, and I've decided that I only want it to have a single file display, and I'll also turn off the viewer pane. So now to save this, I go to Settings, Lister Layouts, Save This Lister. And now it remembers the name of the layout, so I don't have to find it from the drop-down list. And the other options are also set as they were for that layout. So normally you just have to click OK, and you're done. And there it is, updated. A new Advanced Preferences option has been added so that you can display file sizes using the SI units or using the MIB-KIB suffixes. By default it uses the Windows standard, which is multiples of 1024 using the MB, KB and so on suffixes, but you can change to using multiples of 1000 using the MB, KB and so on suffixes, or the third option is to use multiples of 1024 and the MIB, KIB and so on suffixes. So that's the end of the video. As always, these are only highlights, and you should see the release notes for the complete list of new features and bug fixes. Hope you enjoy these videos, and we'll see you in the next one.